A month ago, Hamas decided to go to the land of Israel and kill approximately 1,400 people. Not only kill, but actually murder 1,400 people. Men, women, children. That wasn't enough. Women, children, they've been kidnapped. And today, Hamas holds approximately 230 hostages. It's been approximately a month since what happened, and I'm gonna reach the Australia all the way to future and bring Mark Durie to us. Peace of Christ be with you, Mark.
And also with you, Hatun.
Thank you very much for joining me. So those of you who doesn't know who Mark is, well, you need to come to the planet Earth. So Mark, based in Australia, and he's a pastor as well as preacher, teacher. He's the fellow writer for the Middle Eastern Forum, as well as he is senior researcher fellow of the Arthur Jeffery Centre for the Study of Islam in Melbourne School of Theology. He's got quite a lot of books. Couple of things, two books of him I read, which one of them was the Third Choice, Islam, Dimitri, and Freedom. Second is the Quran and Biblical Reflex, as well as he's got book called Witch God. So that will be the God of Bible versus God of Islam, as well as character and beauty of Triune God. Also, another book is Liberty to Captives. So I'll put those links to the description. You can check him out and then see what he's up to, and you can follow his work. So, Mark, you are in the future. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. It's good to be with you. It's amazing we can chat like this. And I'm looking forward to talking about some very serious and actually quite distressing things that are happening.
Thank you for joining us. So, approximately a month ago, 7th of October, Hamas terrorist organization decided to get into the land of Israel and murder children, men, women, even open the tummy of the pregnant woman and kill the baby. Lots of very bad images they were willing to share on the social media, as well as they took many hostages. It's been a month. I'm someone who speaks to Muslims, and I hear the reason of it. I'll put it forward to you, and then you can unpack for me if I if I am wrong. So this is what Muslims tell me, that for 75 years, land of Muslims, land of Palestine, is stolen by Israel. Palestinians have been bullied. They live on open air prison. They've got no life. Everything is just so bad. They want their land back. They want their freedom back. Therefore, Israel has been for decades, Israel has been murdering and killing them. They are freedom fighters who simply want their land back. Is this correct?
It's a long and complicated story, actually. I don't think it is correct. At the beginning of the 20th century, the nations, the League of Nations, made a decision to partition the area called Palestine, southern part of the province of Syria in the Ottoman Empire. And one part would be for Jews and another part would be for others. There were also, from the late 19th century on, many Jews moving into the region, buying up land from Palestinians, from the local residents, and they brought economic development with them, and they were often wealthier. They were better able to make money too. The Palestinian Muslims particularly always objected to the Jewish presence. They rejected partition multiple times. And then when the United Nations sought to partition the country, and Israel had declared its national that it was a state, it's declared its identity, then Israel was attacked by all the surrounding nations. And it's absolutely clear their purpose was to destroy the Jews, but they fought back and they conquered some territory, and some territory they didn't. So the West Bank was conquered by Jordan and occupied by Jordan and incorporated into Jordan. And the Gaza Strip was conquered by, or was taken over by Egypt and was administered by Egypt. Now, some Palestinians stayed in the Jewish settled areas, and they are part of the state of Israel. They're citizens in Israel today, a minority. Others fled. There were hundreds of thousands that fled, and this is what created the refugee problem. But I think over the last century, the Palestinians have repeatedly rejected a two-state solution. The only solution they will accept is maybe a few Jews in a minority position, but never in a majority. And they've always done one thing or another, really, to destroy the possibility of living side by side peacefully. They could have lived side by side peacefully many times, but they've repeatedly rejected it. The only outcome the political movement amongst Palestinians has accepted is the complete destruction of Israel. And that's been means we have a perpetual war that just keeps going on and on. Open air prison, is Gaza an open air prison? I think it's ridiculous language, actually. You've got shopping centers and schools and hospitals, and yes, it's not easy, it's difficult, but and Israel has been guarding entry points in and out of Gaza, but it's certainly not a prison. In fact, policing and administration has been under the control of Hamas in that area for, you know, more than a decade and a half. So a lot of that rhetoric is just completely overblown. It's like when people say that Gaza is the most densely settled place in the world. It's just not true. Singapore is more densely settled, for example, than Gaza. So a lot of the rhetoric is just it's just rhetoric, unfortunately.
So you phrased in a way that people didn't want Jews in the area, therefore there was war. So my understanding with what I'm speaking with Muslims is actually it has nothing to do with religion. It has nothing to do with they are Jews. It is this nation or this state was not there before 1940s, and they came and then stole our land. So it's not about the religion, but also you expressed West Bank was part of Jordan in one point. So are you aware at that stage that people were fighting for, let's so-called freedom, to get out of the Jordan, or would they identify themselves as they are occupied by Jordan at that stage?
Well, at one point there was a Congress of Palestinians in the late 40s, and they voted to become part of Jordan, because actually Transjordan, as it was called, was part of the Palestine Mandate. It was part of it was the east part of Palestine. And there was a vote that both the areas that now is Israel-Palestine and Jordan would be united into one country. So that was one option that they were seeking. To come back to the issue of Jews, it's absolutely clear from the 1930s that the Muslims in Palestine were opposed to Jews being in power. It was as simple as that. They didn't mind Jews living in the area so much as long as they were 20 or 30%, but never in power. And that's what they objected to. They objected to a Jewish state. And it was about the Jews. If it was the fact that they weren't Muslims that they were ruling. And Hamas has made it very clear in its charter and its ideological statements that it is about the Jews. That is, that it's unacceptable that land that's been once conquered by Islam should come under the power of a non-Islamic rule. That's the whole basis of their resistance, that this land should not be ruled by infidels, especially not by Jews, because that is a violation of the principles of Islam.
So sorry, I just need to understand that you are saying, according to the teachings of Islam, that if once the land is being occupied, I'm from Turkey, we kind of usually use the term, we liberate the land or we go and share life with people. So once land is being occupied, that land becomes belong to Muslims or belong to Nation of Islam, so that in the future, if that land is being taken by someone else, that they still feel it is belong to them, therefore they need to go and take it back?
Yeah, so they take it by conquest, but they don't accept anybody else to have the right to conquer it back.
Okay.
So it's so like a door. It's a door that it's like entering Islam. You can go in, but you can't come out. And land can become Islamic, but it can never become un-Islamic.
So you can come out dead.
See, the Hamas Charter says this is true of all lands that have been occupied by Islam. So there are Muslims in North Africa that are waiting to take Spain back. You know, and India should be liberated for Islam. In fact, Islam had this, I mean, the conquests are called openings, opening up the land to freedom. They don't have the idea that Islam, the Arabs, were an imperialistic occupying power that dominated, ultimately replaced in many cases the mainly Christian inhabitants of the Middle East. They don't think that was an issue, a problem at all. In fact, it's a good thing. People should be so grateful to be conquered by Islam. But taking part of the land back, no, that would never be acceptable. So, I mean, Palestine was never a country. I mean, it was never a national entity since the time of the Roman Empire. And it was a part of the province of Syria under the Ottomans. It was not a nation. Actually, in the 30s, the word Palestine was used to refer to Arabs and Jews alike. So a Jew from Israel, what's now Israel, would be called a Palestinian Jew, and you've had Palestinian Arabs and Palestinian Christians. But when the Jews chose Israel as their national identity, they abandoned the term Palestine. And so the Arabs basically picked it up and said, oh, that's us. We're the real Palestinians. And actually they take it to crazy extent. So some Palestinian preachers will say, oh, there were never any Jews here. Never have been any time in history. We've been here for 5,000 years, they say.
Yeah, they take us to Bible and then say, even Bible talks about us. This land is belong to us.
And of course, that doesn't say that. But they have this replacement. It's not only a replacement theology, that is, Islam replaces other religions. It's a geographical replacement as well. Like Islam has taken over this land. No one else is ever allowed to have been here before. In fact, there have been Jews in the region from Roman time to the present. What really made the Arab movement really angry was that more and more Jews moved into the area and they began to buy up land, they began to settle, and their numbers increased. And then they fought for their survival. And to be quite frank, if they hadn't fought in 1948, if they hadn't won victories, they would have been massacred by Egypt, by Jordan, by Syria, by the surrounding nations. And you know, it's really incredibly inconsistent and hypocritical, because the Muslims claim the right to conquer the world, but if anyone else conquers anything that belongs to them, that's a kind of crime against humanity. There's no reciprocity. It's only a one-way street.
Would you say that is like something human heart is like very bad? We want the things that are not belong to us, and then we want more, and then we want more. Do you think that is just like failed human beings, or there is something in the ideology of Islam encourages or commands its followers to do so?
Oh, it's definitely Islamic teaching. So Islam says in the Quran, it says that Muslims are the best people that Allah has raised up for humankind. They command what's right and they forbid what's wrong. Now, you can't do that unless you're in power. And in fact, there's a verse that says the whole earth belongs to Islam, belongs to the people of God. And there's lots of teachings in the Quran that support this. So there's an idea of succeeding, so that there's stories about older peoples that were wiped out and then believers came and replaced them. So this idea of physically replacing people by later peoples is part of the teachings of Islam. That is, Muslims will replace the unbelievers who will be wiped out. In fact, that's what Muhammad's followers did. They killed their opponents, took over their property. Muhammad killed a whole tribe of Jews the Quraysh. He killed them all and took over their wives and children as slaves and took over their properties. And he did the same for many Jews in other settlements as well. So yeah, it's part of it's. Islam is sort of wired for that. It sees conquest as righteous if it does it, but a terrible evil if anyone else does it. There's never been an apology for Islamic conquest. There's never been any act of contrition or regret over the millions killed, the displaced and enslaved. It's just part of the glorious past of Islam.
Would you say it is wrong to use the term Israel occupied Palestine?
Yes,
term
I think
occupation,
it's.
will it be wrong to use?
I think it's wrong for various reasons. One is, well, it's Islamic perspective. They're living in and controlling an area that should be Islamic. So that's a religious perspective. Israel is a state like other state. It's fought for its right to exist, as other states have as well. And it occupies its own territory. It has not been occupying Gaza. It does control the West Bank. And that's a complicated story because you do have settlers seeking to Judaize areas, and as well as the Palestinian Arabs living in that area. I think the whole label of Palestine is really problematic as well. I think it's a mistake. You know, when the Turks, the Ottomans, occupied Palestine for centuries, no one said, oh, this is a wicked or evil occupying force and we have to conduct jihad against the Ottomans until we drive them out and free our beautiful, noble land of Palestine. You know, Arabs in the region didn't have that ideology. And the reason they didn't is because the Ottomans were Muslims and they were ruling on behalf of Islam. And there's a principle in Islam that if someone is ruling on behalf of Islam, you should obey them, but not doesn't work for Jews.
In our history lessons, we learned that actually, like, we never conquered them, we liberated them. We simply went there to share life, and then they've got all these beautiful customs and cultures because we enriched them. So that's what kind of they teach us at schools.
Yes, and the Sultan's harems were full of Christian women who'd been liberated from Georgia and Eastern Europe and lands to the north and become his sex slaves. That was their liberation.
Yeah.
You know, this is a completely distorted view of history. It's not a very humble view of history. It's a view of which says that we were always right and everyone and the infidels are always wrong. I mean, this is a big problem too, because there's so many negative stereotypes about the Jews in the Quran. They're cowardly, they won't fight, they start wars, you can't trust them, they lie. And all those stereotypes just keep on being preached by Hamas all the time. So there's this message of hatred that dehumanizes them. And that dehumanization is part of the reason why those 1,400 or 1,500 people were killed so brutally. Treat people as the Quran even says the Jews were changed into apes and pigs, and so Hamas preachers will call the Jews apes and pigs. So this dehumanization, which is hardwired into Islam, is one of the reasons the conflict keeps going on and on.
Yeah. So from early age, if you train your child to hate people because of their faith, then once they grow up, what are they going to become? They are going to become more haters. And therefore, it is not surprising that people are being killed simply because they do not share the same belief with religion of Islam. So on the 7th of October, I was out of the country, so I just saw on the news that people are running for their life from the concert, and then within a couple of hours, it was the pictures where Hamas terrorists were like recording and then putting that on the social media, what they were doing to the woman, what they were doing to the kids. Even to the elderly. And it was, I think, that day or following day, demonstrations start taking place in England to stand with Palestine against what Israel is doing. It was just like a day after just what happened. What is your reaction? Like, how suddenly the world forgot that terror? And then we start focusing on the terrorists and then try to glorify the terrorists. And then how can we help the terrorists? How can we come alongside of the terrorists?
Yes, well, in Australia, in Sydney, there was a demonstration a day or two later, a marching in through the town. And the Muslims in that demonstration were chanting, gas the Jews, gas the Jews, gas the Jews. This is in the heart of Sydney. The police just watched. They just watched. I think what happened is that simultaneously with the attack in Israel, a word was sent out from Hamas to Muslim organizations around the world, and particularly in the West, to start protesting. That was organized, absolutely organized. And And so you've got, it's actually a threatening show of force. Like Hamas has called for Muslims all over the world to rise up and to show that they are men of steel, you know. And so what happens is that the police, for example, in the UK or in Australia, who've been trained for many years to this sensitivity training to be, you know, protective of these multicultural variation, different types of people, and respectful of difference and respectful of Muslims. This has been an issue that's caused lots of problems in the UK with the rape gangs as well, that the police have not really been willing sometimes to pursue the perpetrators. So the police have been sensitized, and so they don't have the will to stop the protest. They don't want to intervene and stop people shouting "gas the Jews." They prefer just to stand and watch. This has made it has caused a lot of terror in the hearts of Jews in the West. It makes it very frightening, you know, to wear a sign of your Jewish identity becomes frightening, and they want that. They want to cause fear. So those protests are about showing power and showing fear. Of course, the radicals amongst the Muslim community, and not all are radical, but the radicals amongst the community have not gone away. So in Britain, the security forces have been tracking thousands and thousands of potential jihadis for many, many years. That's no secret. And the radical views that were, you know, you'd often find around the time of 9/11 on websites, they haven't gone away. They're still being taught in the mosques. But this event of killing so many Jews all at once, it was very inspirational to the radicals. It's like, we have won a victory. You know, shame has been taken away from us. We are proud that we have been able to outsmart these people. And these killings show that we will kill them too. It's like a down payment. Take that. This is what we want to do with you. So this causes a rising up of enthusiasm. I mean, one of the preachers from Al-Azhar University was saying, you know, you've taken away our shame. You have made us feel human again. Or a preacher in Melbourne said, this is a day of happiness. This is a day of joy. This is the day we've been waiting for. He's speaking about babies being shot and people's eyeballs being dug out of faces and women being raped until their pelvis breaks. You know, this is what that means. And now the issue for people in the West, for people who are not Muslims, how do they respond to all this? And sometimes people speak about fight or flight. You know, when you're cornered, you can fight or you can run away. But there's another response that a dog can make, and that is to tend and befriend. So someone threatens the dog and the dog comes up and licks your feet. And I think that's one of the responses to terror, that you reach out in friendship. You refuse to accept. You deny the terror and you try and overcome it. And through through positive relationship. And I think that's a risk for people, say in Britain or the UK. They see this thing as actually very frightening. So they say, oh, we will be friends with Muslims. We will advocate them. We will support them. And then we'll be safe. Because basically this is terrifying.
Wouldn't you say that's like would take back what you little bit only expressed in 1920s? There were Jews and there were Muslims, Christians, atheists, all that people group in the land of Israel, Palestine. Palestine people have no problem with Jews because they were just minority and they were friendly towards one another. And then once they took over, then things changed. So once I think as we, it is shame we become alongside of the terrorists by like, oh yeah, I am your friend. Once they take over, I don't think they are gonna think me as their friend.
I wouldn't say
Jews on 7th October.
Well, some were friends, but there were also a series of pogroms and attacks against Jews in the late 19th and 20th century in Palestine. It wasn't perfect. And look, visitors to the Ottoman Empire in the 19th and 18th century speak about how terribly Jews were treated by Muslims at that time. So, but they were tolerated. But they're only tolerated as long as they don't have power, as long as they don't have weapons. You know, one of the principles of the Dhimma, the covenant of Christians or Jews living under Islam, is that they were not allowed to have any means of defending themselves. So they were tolerated, but in a very vulnerable state. So this idea that the Jews would fight for themselves was very shocking. the Quran says the Jews won't fight. It says they'll run away, they'll turn away. And repeatedly Muslims have thought, oh, we'll defeat them easily. We're Muslims. They're Jews. They love life. They say, you love life, we love death. So we're willing to die, but you'll surrender rather than die. And they've said that again and again. And every time they've kind of depended on that, they've been defeated. But there's the constant religious script that that inspires these sorts of attacks.
Yeah. It was very helpful. You pointed out how people were celebrating and then expressing that now their shame is being taken away. Now they can feel human again because what Hamas did on 7th of October. Versus I am looking at those pictures and I am saying, if there is a God who says, yeah, put terror in their hearts, Allah and his angels causes terror in the hearts of disbelievers, put terror in their hearts, and Jewish people couldn't even go on the streets, feel comfortable and safe. So you are causing terror and you are rejoicing in that. You are expressing that our shame is taken away. We can feel human again. It all tells me that you have a God who simply rejoices and being fed by the blood and suffering of humans. And that helps me to see like beauty of my triune God, because my God couldn't stand the suffering of his people. He stepped in and then gave himself on the cross for humanity. Just great, great way to help me to think about character of my God. So thank you for that.
Yeah, I think there's a whole series of what are called punishment stories in the Quran where God destroys whole peoples who've rejected him. And they are considered to be the just and right treatment of anyone who doesn't support the program. So this idea of destroying peoples, nations, it's part of Islamic kind of worldview.
So it was, I think, Friday after 7th of October where it was expressed, it was the World Jihad Day. So they were encouraged to go out and then do jihad for what is happening in Palestine and in Israel. I was in a mosque. I go to mosques quite a lot, and it was one of the mosques I felt very, very uncomfortable what has been preached, how people were encouraged to do things. And at the end, I was speaking with one of the gentlemen from the mosque. And then he expressed that because Muslim people have been living, he's not talking about Gaza or West Bank, he was talking about Muslim people in Palestine. They live like a concentration camp. Their life is not much different than what Jews lived in 1940s. So therefore, they have all the rights to go and kill their people who put them there. What are your thoughts on that? Because I'm just like thinking, looking at the history in 1940s, when some of them were able to run away from the concentration camps, or when they left the concentration camps, they didn't first thing went out and then kill people. Versus in here, it seems Muslim mind is thinking like, okay, now I was in this difficult situation, therefore it gives me all the right to go and kill people. It's like, you know, when we say on the news, oh, this guy had a broken childhood, therefore when he goes and then shoots all the students in the school, all the kids in the school, we simply justify that because he had a broken background. What are your thoughts on that?
I think the rhetoric about the concentration camp is really wrong. It's false. It's a false story. Yes, it's difficult for Palestinians in Gaza, but they have supermarkets and multi-story buildings, and they have their own elected government, Hamas, who manages their lives, and they have a lot of money that's provided by the United Nations and other countries to support them, enabling them to live. It's not great, but it's certainly not a concentration camp. They're not, I think there's a tendency to use language associated with Nazism and with the Jews and to turn it back so the Jews become the Nazis. It's a hateful, it's a really horrible trope. It's a kind of way of twisting and saying, you know, you are the Nazis, we are the pure, righteous people. It's like some Muslims have said, oh, when Jesus comes back, he'll destroy the Jews, you know. It's really bizarre. But could I just say a bit about this sense of victimhood, Islamic victimhood? One of the Hamas spokespeople, Ghazi Hamad, he said, "We are the victims. No one should blame us for the things we do. Everything we do is justified because we're victims." Now, this too is an Islamic concept. In the Quran, it says that fitna is worse than killing. Fitna means persecution or trouble for Muslims. So for Muslims to have burdens or to be troubled or disturbed is worse than killing. So it's better to kill non-Muslims than to have Muslims under pressure. And it says, fight them or kill them until there's no more fitna. So what happened in the origin of Islam was that the many killings that Muhammad oversaw and that the Muslim followers did was justified on the basis of the greater victimhood of Muslims. And so this idea that Muslims are the victims has become part of an Islamic worldview, a tradition. There was once a debate between Wafa Sultan, who'd left Islam, and an Algerian professor. And she was saying, well, you know, Muslims have done these things which are bad. He began to scream and he began to say, we are the victims. We are the victims. Your victims are in the tens or the tens, maybe even the thousands. Our victims are in the millions. And I was listening to this and it's really tragic. It's a tragic point of view because it means that it's always someone else's fault. Whatever issues you have in your life, it's somebody else's fault. You know, we blame somebody else. And then people get very mixed up about who to blame. I mean, for example, the Palestinians in Gaza have no bomb shelters for civilians. In fact, we're told that the tunnels have hundreds of thousands of booby traps on them. So Hamas has made no provision for its civilians to be protected. They want them to be killed. And yet the whole world is saying, oh, this is the war crime is Israel. Hamas puts its military command posts under a hospital. And people are saying people don't call it out as a war crime, which it is. It's a war crime to deliberately put civilians in harm's way. But what's so confused is this Islamic view that Muslims are always the greatest victims in the world, has become kind of part of the Western thinking as well, and it's been accepted without critical thought. Israel is still trying to avoid civilian casualties. It's still creating safety routes for the civilians to get out. It's being attacked by Hamas as it does it, and yet the whole world is just full of this hatred of the Jews. It's really perverted and confused, and you know, my heart bleeds for the Palestinians. It's terrible what they're going through, but the blame for that belongs significantly to Hamas.
So I watched an interview where Hamas leader was expressing how they spent whole year pretending that they are doing government business, building all these like new hotels projects, but actually under it they were simply building those tunnels. What are your thoughts on like giving the impression that like now we changed, we are doing what we're supposed to do, but on your back they are just simply building tunnels to figure out how they are going to attack? Like they expressed how they spent whole year to plan it, but sadly they didn't even want to think about.
Well, it's actually
those kids, and
it's actually extraordinary when you think about it that they planned to turn Gaza City into a war zone full of civilians. That's their plan. That's their plan to defeat Israel, is to turn their own society into a battleground, where civilians have no protection and they have underground tunnels and they want Israel to come and attack them. That's what they're planning for.
So you are saying they expected this from Israel. Israel like would come and then harm them, yet they still went for it?
Yes, one of the reasons they did that, murdering 1,500 people, was to cause a war with Israel. They wanted to force it. They want to force it so that the Muslim world will no longer continue with the accords with Israel. They wanted to raise up sympathy from other Islamic nations for their plight. They've been preparing for war in their own backyard, and they've been getting ready for who? Well, for the Israelis to come. They have sought that. They definitely prepared for that. It's their intention. It's what they've been military planning. That's what their military's been planning for all this time. They have planned for nothing else. You know, one thing to think about is this, is that if Hamas laid down its weapons peace would start. But if the Israelis lay down their weapons, they will be massacred. And that's the difference between the two sides at present. You know, it's Hamas has brought this on. They've deliberately created this situation.
Why do you think they wanted their citizen to be killed? Like, you would expect, I pay lots of money to my government as a tax for them to provide my basic needs, look after me, even uphold my rights. So I would expect that's my government's like normal job. Yeah. Like I wasn't, but why Hamas doesn't think about its citizens and then like even uses their citizen as human shield? So
well,
like
it does think about them. It uses them. They believe that if you're killed by the infidels in a jihad, which is what this is, you go straight to paradise. So it's good for those people. It's good news for them. And the Hamas spokespeople repeatedly say things like, we know that this will cost us. We know that this will be costly, but we will win. When they say costly, they mean, you know, civilians will be killed. They're ready for that. Why do they want that? Well, they want that because they know that in the Muslim world, Muslim victims will cause people to rise up and to offer to volunteer to help in the fight. So they see it as a recruitment drive. It's a its purpose is to draw more people into the conflict. They want to, secondly, they want to show how evil and wicked the Jews are and the Israelis. So they want to be able to report lots of casualties. I mean, it's horrible, really. One of them was asked, why haven't you built bomb shelters? And he said, oh, that's the UN's job, protecting people. That's not our job. Our job is just to fight Israel. But look, think about it. Suppose Hamas has 30...
Sorry, repeat that again for me.
A Hamas leader said, it's not our job to protect the Gaza civilians. That's the UN's job. These are refugees. The UN should be protecting them, not us. But when you think about it, Hamas, which has maybe 30,000 soldiers, has attacked a state with nuclear weapons and armies of hundreds of thousands. Who does that? I mean, who goes out and brutally murders and tortures and rapes and kills and people when you're like a mouse trying to take on an elephant? Well, one of the reasons why they do it is they really believe they can win. They think the Quran has told them they can win. They think the Jews won't fight. They think Allah has decreed. They think that the Muslim world would rise up to support them. They want to trigger that. So the more catastrophic the event is, the more it feeds into that view. And it's that's their logic. They, from their point of view, one of them said, we would do the same thing over and over again. And one person said, we would do it a million times. We would kill this 1,500 people a million times over if it's necessary. So that's the problem. That's the worldview, really.
That shows me like they are actually not willing to have peace. They just want their citizens to be killed. And they think this is good for Islam. It makes Islam good. Actually, it's just a horrible thing. You don't even care your fellow human.
It's very hard to comprehend it, but it has its own logic. It has its own thinking about it, and they're being successful because they turned back all their casualties onto the Israelis.
Yeah, like now, in England, you go to the marches, you've got hundreds of thousands of people who are simply screaming from river to sea, free Palestine, and Khaybar, Khaybar. Happening again, all that, and like they were able to win the sympathy of the world simply using their humans as a shield and crying this victim game.
Well, it's a fruit of many things. It's not just these events. It's a series of relationships that have been built up in countries like Britain over many decades.
Yeah.
There's also a kind of undercurrent of Western anti-Semitism, anti-Jewish sentiment that's rising as well, that they've been playing on. They've also been, Muslims in the West have been, in Europe have been pushing anti-Semitism for a long time. It's been growing for decades. So a lot of these things are kind of coming together. And, you know, you'll have politicians whose electorates are significant Muslim minorities, and they're in a position where they need to support the sentiment on the street. So there's lots of factors that have brought us to this place.
Yeah.
Israel really has to fight for its survival. From the river to the sea means, you know, if there are a few million Jews, we're going to kill most of them. That's what it means. It means genocide now. That's what they want. They'll leave a few because, a small number is acceptable, but many will be killed. And I actually think that attack on October the 7th was like a foretaste. This is what we want to do to you. You need to understand this is our intention. And it's meant to be terrifying, to cast terror in the hearts of the unbelievers, as the Quran says. Yeah, it's what's happening in the West is particularly disturbing, I think. But it's the result of policies over many decades.
So we've seen in Harvard University, they wrote down approximately 10,000 people who were killed in Palestine. They wrote their names down. If someone puts a flyer where it is expressing kidnapped Israeli, bring them home, those flyers are being taken away even by police. And if you are criticizing or if you are expressing your feelings regarding the flux of Palestine on the streets of London, you get arrested for that. You can't turn up the marches with Israeli flag, because apparently Muslims are majority in those marches and police ask you to leave, otherwise you are breaching the peace. It is very disturbing how we simply come alongside of terrorism and we forget about victims.
Yes, it's become...
I find very disturbing.
Yes, it is disturbing. I mean, when communism was introduced in Russia, they went through this period called the Red Terror, where many people were tortured and killed in large numbers. And it was like you can't make an omelet without breaking eggs. So these were considered by the communist ideologues to be acceptable casualties. And one of the girls one of the young students who was supporting the Palestinian rally in Sydney, she said, oh, decolonization is messy, meaning, oh, yeah, some people are going to get raped and children will be killed and, you know, enslaved and all that sort of stuff. But that's just because it's messy. You know, it's inevitable. We'll accept it. So what's happened is amongst some in the West, it's become acceptable to discount human life and to make excuses for brutal torture and kind of blatant destruction of people. This is troubling. It's really deeply troubling for us. Yeah, and it's madness. As I said, for Hamas, which is a fraction of the size of Israel, to go into Israel and kill women, children, men, young and old, torturing parents in front of their children and vice versa. You know, what strategic advantage can that serve? It's not only horrible in itself, it's kind of absolutely insane as a strategy. And it's really telling Israel, you have to destroy us or we will destroy you. That's really what Hamas is saying. And they're playing the victim card as well. So, yeah, it's a very perverted and confused set of circumstances. Troubling for people, I think.
So on 7th October, Hamas committed war crime by raping, killing women, children, to elder, and rejoicing that even chopping the tummy of the woman and then even killing the baby in that tummy. Those are all war crimes, but they are able to get away with this kind of thing, seems. Is there any hope? I know as a Christian, I always have hope, but it's just so dark. The way Western part of the world reacts is very dark. You just watch the clips, doesn't matter Israel or people in Palestine, children are dying without knowing that they are forgiven by the blood of Lord Jesus Christ. So that's harsh by itself. But is there any hope? You expressed that today, if Israel puts down their gun, there will be massacre. If Hamas puts down their gun, there will be peace. Doesn't look like anyone is up for it.
Well, Hamas has made absolutely clear that their goal is to destroy Israel. And this, given it's put Israel in the position where it has to destroy Hamas. So what Israel will do is try and destroy all the people it can find. And it's said that it will take over security. And that means it'll basically reoccupy Gaza. And, you know, this Islamic ideology of war, which is so brutal in this case, forces, I think it forces the other side to aim for complete victory. Surrender is basically what Israel wants Hamas to do. And I don't think they've got any other choice but to fight for that. And, you know, people that say, oh, Israel should stop and they shouldn't be continuing to fight Hamas in Gaza or causing civilian casualties, people that say that need to explain, in their view, how Israel can win this war, because fighting it forever is not an option. Letting this sort of event happen again and again is just not an option. So in what way can they win the war against Hamas except by attacking it in the places where it has entrenched itself? It's dug itself in Gaza City and in the Gaza Strip, ready for battle. How are you going to defeat them except by going in there? And the Israelis have warned the Palestinian civilians, asked them to leave. Hamas was the ones forcing them to stay. They've given them an opportunity to get out of there, but now Israel needs to get on with the battle. It's troubling because the ideology that drives Hamas is not, in the end, it won't finish with Israel. I mean, they've made that very clear themselves, that their goal is not so much the freedom of Palestine from Israel or the Jews, but actually the establishment of the caliphate. And from time to time, preachers will say, oh, we will take this battle to London and to Japan and to America. And so the warning here is that this is not just a battle that will stop there. It's a battle that will continue. And many parts of Africa are being torn apart by jihad at the moment. We've already seen Syria and Iraq gravely damaged. The ideology that drives Hamas is not just concerned about Israel. It's concerned about the rule of Allah in the world. And so, yeah, we need to be paying attention. Europe needs to be paying attention and think very deeply about how they're going to manage the future with these sorts of forces being allowed to grow in the nation. It's difficult times ahead.
Okay. And my last question it would be, because we are almost an hour and a half, 47 minutes or so. What is the Christian response to that? This, what's happening there?
That's complicated. I mean, I think we need to understand there's two different issues. One is Jesus said, forgive your enemies, love your enemies, don't hate them. So whoever your enemies are, in whatever context, we're called to recognize the dignity in every human person and to appreciate the value of a human life and never to dehumanize people, always to see people as human beings, no matter which side they're on. So that's our individual calling. At the same time, states, governments have to protect their people. They've got a job to do. And unfortunately, that sometimes involves war. And I think Christians need to understand that there is such a thing as a just war, a war with reasonable ends. And I think there are circumstances where that sort of war needs to be fought. And those wars can be incredibly bloody and damaging and destructive. I mean, the Second World War, the Allies who won that had to fight very bitterly and often with great damage to civilians in order to defeat Germany. It was not easy, and nor was it kind of morally pure in a way, but it was a battle for survival of Europe. So I think Christians need to be realistic that if you have an enemy that wants to kill you and rape your wife and steal your children, that this is not something that can just be resolved through simple peace talks. This is a deeper more problematic issue. I'm not someone who ascribes to the view that Israel is like the kingdom of God, or that it's a perfect nation, or that it's Israel right or wrong. That's not my view. It's, we should judge Israel according to reasonable standards and what it does in war and in peace. But there's, in my mind, there's absolutely no comparison between Israel and Hamas. Hamas is brutal. It oppresses its own people. One of the terrible ironies of the from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free, is that, does that mean Hamas will be the rulers of Palestine? Is that what freedom looks like? Is that going to be the situation like you have in Iran, where you have an aggressive, a brutal, corrupt state running the nation? Do you really want that kind of freedom? Because that's what will eventuate, and it'll be an open wound in the Middle East if that happens. It's not going to be a beautiful or pretty free. It's not freedom in anything like the way we understand it. So I think my belief is Israelis have to fight for their freedom. They have to defeat Hamas. They won't completely defeat the ideology. Came out of the Muslim Brotherhood. It's widely held by many Muslims around the world. That's not going to go away. But Israel, knowing that the ideology is there and that it's unforgiving and it's not going to accept peace or a two-state solution, Israel needs to fight for its safety and security accordingly. And I think as a Christian, I acknowledge that. It's regrettable. It's tragic, particularly for the Palestinians, the civilians there. And that's a source for great sorrow. But that's the nature of the war, I think.
I apologize. I said that was my last question, but I've got two questions came to my mind. Is that okay if I ask them?
Of course.
Sorry. Just a comment on what you said, or add what you said. Like, as a Christian, I am looking at the Bible and I'm seeing the character of God, who is identified as love, and how he did that. Father looks at the world, Son looks at the world, Spirit looks at the world, and then see the suffering. Out of love, out of concern, Son comes to give himself for the world. So love, that, like, I'm reading from that, is love by default needs to be protected. So if I love someone, I need to protect. I hear quite a lot from Muslims, they are saying, oh, well, why don't you turn other cheek? Why don't you turn other cheek? But if I love someone, and sadly, but I've got only two cheeks, and for 1,400 years, my cheeks are being hurt. So there is no other cheek to turn. I love someone by default. I've got to protect them. I need to show my love to them by protecting. I can't say like, oh, yeah, you raped my family. I'll put my guns down so you come and rape again. So I need to step in and then stop that. My question was going to be in the lines of, I was told by Muslim that, and also pro-Palestinians who are not Muslims, Hamas actually created by Israel, versus you expressed that Hamas was created by Muslim Brotherhood. Is it not Israel? Is it Muslim Brotherhood?
It came out of the Muslim Brotherhood, which came out of Egypt originally, and therefore was very active in Gaza. It's one of the strongholds of the Muslim Brotherhood in Gaza. And that's historically why Hamas is stronger in Gaza than it is in the West Bank. But the goal of the Muslim Brotherhood is to establish the caliphate. Hamas was established with the purpose of liberating Palestine. But its ideology is just straight Muslim Brotherhood, and the Muslim Brotherhood's ideology is anti-Semitic as well. That goes back a long way. So this is often, I've often heard people say that, oh, the conflict was never religious until the Israelis started it. That's not true. It's always been religious on the Islamic side. I think the answer to all this is actually a relationship with Christ. You know, I have a lovely Iranian friend, and he's a Christian, and when he was in Iran, every Friday they would have big mass cursing sessions in the mosque and the town square. They'd be cursing the Jews. So, you know, hundreds or a thousand men would come and they'd all curse the Jews for an hour or two. Then they go back and do whatever they do, run their shops and everything. And he was standing there while this was happening and he thought, who are these people? Why does their government hate them so much? I don't like the government. Maybe these are good people. Maybe that's why they hate them. And he decided a great love for the Jews arose in his heart. And when he came to Australia and he gave his life to Jesus, he joined a messianic congregation. So now he worships the Lord in the presence of Jews, and he's very happy there. I just wish there were more people like that that could say, what is this hatred for? You know, what is it? What point does it have? You know, if the Arabs had not had this passionate hatred of the Jews and a rejection of them as a kind of powerful group in the country, they could be living together happily for the last 100 years. You know, this whole conflict has been driven, I think, by religious sentiments and often masks and pretending to be other things. But the answer, I think, is to be found in the Prince of Peace, and we must pray for the peace of Jerusalem, pray for those that are suffering at this time. One more final thought I had, Hatun. It's said of Jesus in John's Gospel that he was full of grace and truth. And you could think of grace as love, and because it's an undeserved favor. Grace is undeserved favor, which is an act of love. Loving your enemy is an undeserved kindness towards someone who you should, by all rights, be opposed to. And so Jesus presents both these things together, love and truth. And one of the problems, the sicknesses of our society in the West, is that we've gone all the way with love, but we've abandoned truth. And we react from the heart, and sometimes with a kind of over a lot of compassion, but not in a truth-based way. And whenever you have love without truth, you get abuse. Let me give you an example, like a battered woman whose husband is attacking her and brutally hurting her, and she loves him, but she's unable to say, this is wrong. I need to get out of this relationship. I need help. This should not be happening to me. Instead, she says, oh, I deserve this, you know, but I love him. And that she's trapped in a cage of love without truth. And we need truth in these things, not just the kind of gut reaction of emotion. And that's, we need to hold both together. We have to be very strong in love and very strong in truth. They're not in competition with each other. And it's a lie that the world tells us that we must have one or the other. We need to have both and be fiercely committed to both love and truth.
Yeah, and Jesus says truth will set you free.
That's true. And we've been losing truth in lots of ways in the public square, and we're entering into a particular kind of bondage. And that's really quite, you know, disturbing.
Thank you very much for joining me from the future and helping us to unpack and reflect what happened a month ago. And thank you also for reminding me once again that the world is broken and dark. Human beings are made in the image of God, and Lord Jesus Christ, eternal Son of the Father, give himself for them. Therefore, we love humanity. We value them. We want them to know Lord Jesus Christ. We want them to have union with Christ. And we look at the world and we see people are dying with not knowing that they are forgiven by the blood of Jesus. That breaks our heart. But it reminds us Isaiah 8, Isaiah 9, in the time of darkness, solution to this darkness is not more guns, is not the princes, it is not the rulers, but solution to this darkness is a child. Son is given, scripture says. So that brings our attention to the, once again, the world needs Prince of Peace. And we pray that until Prince of Peace comes, that people will know truth and grace and love of Lord Jesus Christ. Mark, once again, thank you very much for joining me. God bless you.
It's a pleasure, Hatun. I know you really love Muslim people, and may the Lord bless you in that, in your ministry too.